Hello, everyone, and welcome to another weekly Devo Time. This week, I thought I would talk about a really incredible story in our Bible. It's found in John chapter 11. For most of you, it probably is a familiar story, but for some of you, you've maybe never heard of this story before. The story is the death of Lazarus, and it's found in John chapter 11. I wanted to specifically look at this story today because I think it's a good tie-in to a message I gave two Sundays ago on suffering and yesterday's message on hope. Hope means confidence, assurance. And I talked a couple weeks ago about how we don't really understand suffering. I don't believe that we as the North American church, the Western church, really understand suffering. Suffering is a big topic. Now, we understand pain, we understand frustration, we understand hopelessness, things like that, because of some of our circumstances, and I'm going to talk about that more specifically. But we don't really understand suffering as the Middle Eastern church would, or the early church of Jesus Christ in the book of Acts and in places like that. So I want to tie in kind of the topic of suffering, the topic of hopelessness, and the topic of hope with looking at this very incredible story found in John chapter 11. So if you have your Bibles or a Bible app on your phone, whatever it might be, feel free to follow along with me. I'm going to be reading for a little bit here, as I want us to get a real clear understanding of the story in its entirety. So John chapter 11 says this. It says, "Now a man named Lazarus was sick. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay sick, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair." And that's another incredible story in our scriptures. It says, "So the sister sent word to Jesus, 'Lord, the one you love is sick.' When he heard this, Jesus said, 'This sickness will not end in death. No, in fact, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it.' Jesus loved Martha and her sister Lazarus. Yet when he heard that Lazarus was sick, he stayed where he was for 2 more days. Then he said to his disciple, 'Let us go back to Judea.' 'But Rabbi,' they said, 'a short while ago the Jews tried to stone you, and yet you are going to go back there?' Jesus answered, 'Are there not 12 hours of daylight? A man who walks by day will not stumble, for he sees by this world's light. It is when he walks by night that he stumbles, for he has no light.' After he had said this, he went on to tell them, 'Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him up.' His disciples replied, 'Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better.' Jesus had been speaking of his actual death, but his disciples thought that Jesus actually meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, 'Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him.' Then Thomas, called Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, 'Let us also go, that we may die with him.'" See, the disciples were literally afraid Jesus was going to get killed on this trip to go and see his friend Lazarus. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again. He will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she told him. "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world." And after she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house, comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit, and he was troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. And then it says, Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he have opened the eyes of the blind man, have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there will be a bad odor, for he has been there for 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary had seen what Jesus did, put their faith in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. Then the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin. They called this meeting because they were super upset and angry with Jesus because of what he did. And they were jealous of him. And that was another spot in Scripture, a defining spot in Scripture where the Pharisees make their plan to plot to kill Jesus. Now, how does this tie in a little bit to suffering and pain and hope? Well, in this book called Comforts from the Cross by Elise M. Fitzpatrick, and she's a wonderful author. She's got, I think, approximately 24 books. I came across this chapter called From Suffering to Glory. Now, her chapters in this specific book are only like 3 pages each. They're super easy read, and that's the type of reading that I enjoy. But it's very interesting because when we think about the story of Lazarus, many of us make these same arguments in our own lives. When we go through a stressful time or something like that. And so we often say, "Lord, if you had only been here in this situation, Lord, if you would have only heard my cry, if you would have only answered my prayer." And we get into these types of questions, and I don't think they're terrible questions. God can handle our tough questions. He can handle our cries to him in terms of our frustrations and our pains and so forth. But I think there are some things, very specific things, that we can learn in this. One of the things we need to learn is that our timing, our earthly timing, is completely different than God's eternal timing. Now, Jesus is very clear that this specific story has happened to bring glory to himself. Everything that Jesus does actually is to bring glory to himself and glory to God the Father. And so this author brought up some interesting things. I was thinking about this frustration that Mary and Martha would have had in this waiting period of time, this couple days that they're waiting for Jesus to come and essentially resurrect or heal Lazarus. And we get frustrated with those waiting times. But it says this, Elise says this in her book, and this is from page 72. She says, Jesus waited 12 years. Jesus waited 12 years to heal the woman with the issue of blood. Another lame man had been hoping for healing for 38 years before Jesus commanded him, "Get up, take your bed, and walk." And that's in John chapter 5, verse 8. He waited 4 days to raise his friend from the dead. Now why? Jesus tells it, it is for his glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now I want to continue to read on in here because I think the rest of this little chapter explains a lot about this idea of suffering and how do we make sense of suffering? How do we come to a place of peace in regards to suffering? So as she says here, she says, "I look at this story and so many others. I see something different here. I see Jesus raising a man who had been in the tomb 4 days, and I know that nothing is impossible." This is what I spoke about yesterday, or on Sunday, I should say, in church, when I talked about the message of hope. And I just reiterated that point over and over again. Luke chapter 1, verse 37. Nothing is impossible with God. She goes on to say this. She says, sure, Jesus could have instantly alleviated the family's suffering, but Jesus is more interested in our eternal cure than he is in our temporal relief. Let me repeat that. Jesus is more interested in our eternal cure than he is in our temporal relief. Jesus is not a genie in a bottle, nor is he a heartless despot. He is your compassionate Savior. He is our compassionate and loving Savior. That is why he waited until all hope was gone before he went back to Bethany, intent on blessing his friends and infuriating his enemies. He had already tallied up the cost of this act of love. He traversed the 25 miles to raise his friend from the dead and lay down his own life if need be. He didn't delay because he was unfazed by his friend's suffering. He was infuriated by the effects of sin. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. This broken and fallen world we live in, death is a part of it because of sin. She goes on to say, the eternal Son of God, who celebrated in infinite bliss and glory, wept. And then he cried out in joyous power, "Lazarus, come out." I don't know what you are suffering from right now, the author goes on to say, this lady goes on to say. She says, but Jesus does. Remember that Jesus does know what you are going through. He is not petty in picking off details. He's not like a God, an angry, malicious God up there who's picking the petals off of a flower going, well, I think I'll help her, or I think I'll help him, or I won't help him. He's nothing like that. He's bearing your suffering and has entered into every bit of it, but he is waiting. Now, this line is amazing. If you have a journal or if you like to journal, I would write this down. I would put this somewhere. I would remember it. It says this. She says this. She says, perhaps your deliverance will come before you take your next breath. Perhaps it will come as you take your last breath. That's a phenomenal statement. I'm going to read it again. Perhaps your deliverance will come before you take your next breath. Perhaps it will come as you take your last breath. She goes on to say, I don't know, but I do know that he has made a promise to you. If you believe in him, you will see the glory of God. John chapter 11, verse 40. Just imagine that. Hang on to him in faith and imagine that you will see the glory of God. Your eyes will be open to see how truly wise, powerful, and good God is. Somehow, in some hidden way, your weak eyes, your suffering, is making a way for that to happen. I don't know when your Lazarus will rise, she says, but when he does, you will see something you could never have imagined. When your Lazarus rises, when your suffering ends, when your hope is fulfilled, you will see something that you could never have imagined. you will see God's glory. You will begin to see him as he is, and then you will understand. She ends with a prayer, and I actually want to read this prayer to you. She says this. She says, "My Father, please give me grace to believe. Please give me grace to believe. It's so easy for me to see what I'm suffering and to be confused about your glorious and your mysterious purposes. Like my sisters, Mary and Martha, I always want to say, if you would just have been here. It's easy for me to think that way, that I can control the good by my good works, or that you don't really love me as I am. So I pray that you in your grace, that you would remind me that you are here and that you are working toward a better good than I could ever imagine. You want me to see your glory, how wonderful and wise you are. Lord, help me believe that your glory is worth this suffering, just as you knew that my seeing it was worth yours." And then she says, amen. So I hope that maybe helps you understand a little bit, maybe pulls out some things about this incredible story of Lazarus in the Bible in John chapter 11, about how God's timing is different than ours. It's just natural. It's humanly natural for us to be so frustrated with things that we don't see being fixed, with the sin around us, with the despair, the things like cancer and so forth, all these things. But if we're patient with it, if we continue to be faithful in God, he will continue to be faithful with us. And at the end of the day, we will see God's glory because of it. I hope you're all doing well. I hope you're staying safe. If anyone needs anything, please don't hesitate to send me a message. You can message me through Facebook, through email, call me on my cell phone, whatever it might be. I want to be here for you as best as I can. God bless. Stay safe and have a great week. Bye-bye.